Let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, this is the first trial of the audio system, and it took a little bit of doing to get it to start to work. And I'm sure there are people joining in from Asia, Oceania, Europe, United States, Americas. So without any further ado, let us begin with Luisa Piccarreta. The purpose of this online course on divine will spirituality is to introduce all of you who have not heard of Luisa before to not only the writings, but the message contained therein of a great gift that God has reserved for these end times. The reason why God has reserved this gift for these end times and revealed it to the little daughter of the divine will, Luisa Piccarreta, is because in these end times, there is the greatest conflict and battle underway. The greatest outpouring of evil is occurring. And God, who foresees all things before they occur, has provided in advance the remedy, even indeed before the foundation of the world. This is a teaching of the faith, the Christian faith, that God foresees all things. It's known as God's omniscience. God is all-knowing. He foresaw before the actual rebellion of the angels and the fall of Adam and Eve and these end times outpouring of evil, all these events, and therefore in his eternal mind provided the remedy before he went ahead with the plan of creation. And this is a mystery to the finite human mind. That is, why and how God could know that evil would emerge from what he creates and yet go ahead with the creation. Some people don't accept that a God who is all good can allow evil to emerge from his creation. And some people also have great difficulty with God choosing an apostle who would betray him, lead to his crucifixion, and who would end up, as Jesus tells the servant of God, Luisa, in hell for all eternity. These are the mysteries of God's omniscience. But we do know by faith that there is a reason, there is a rationality behind this. That is, God, who foresees all things, allows them because he sees how even evil that emerges from his creation works for a greater good for those who love him. See, that's the rationale. This is why God allows evil. So people who are scandalized by the fact that God, who is all good, can allow evil to emerge from his own creation and can choose an apostle who will turn against him, can be part of that divine plan. That is all good. This is the mystery of God's omniscience. And Paul talks about this too. He says that all things work for the good of those who love Christ, who are called according to his purpose. And this is the mystery behind the revelations of the servant of God, Luisa Piccarreta. You cannot understand this gift of living in the divine will until you first understand how God can permit evil for a greater good for those who love him. He doesn't permit it for a great, he doesn't permit a greater good for those who do not love him, because it doesn't help them if they don't convert and turn to God. But for those who do love him, it doesn't simply turn out to be a good. That is the evil that emerges from creation, but a greater good. And this is known in theology as happy thought. In Latin, felix culpa. And this Latin expression comes right out of the writings of Saint Augustine, the 4th century theologian from Germany, who was great at understanding the meaning beneath the biblical texts. He was able to peer behind the nude and crude letter, so to speak, of the author, to unflesh the inner meaning, and was able to realize, as did St. Paul before him, how God can bring about good even from evil, and not just good, but a greater good. And Jesus reveals this truth throughout Luisa's writings. Jesus tells Luisa that because of his incarnation, he raised human nature to a greater dignity and glory than that which human nature would have enjoyed had there been no sin. And this is a beautiful and encouraging lesson to many of us who are conceived, all of us who are conceived in sin. It means that God can take your past, which may be marred with sin, impurity, and he can use it in such a way that it doesn't simply restore to you your primordial innocence before you sinned, but elevate you to a state in which you surpass that of your primordial innocence. Jesus tells Luisa, because of his incarnation, he had endowed human nature with the pearls, the diamonds of his virtues, of his passion, of the shedding of his blood, which greater enriched human nature. And this is at the foundation of the revelations of the servant of God, Luisa. Okay. So now, without any further ado, let us begin this online course on living in the divine will by addressing what we have to, which is theology. All right? Theology. All right, so let us begin with the theology, because remember, this is an online study of the theology, not in a very abstract, scientific, analytical way, but in a very simple yet systematic way of understanding Luisa's writings. How do we begin? We begin with the bulwark of our faith. This is the word that comes right out of St. Paul's letter to Timothy. The bulwark of our faith is the church. And the church is the medium through which we understand Luisa's writings. Okay? So let us begin with the three founts of our Christian faith. When I say Christian, I mean Catholic, I mean Orthodox, I even mean Protestant. Why do I say Protestant? Because we are all baptized in Christ. All three of these Christian branches form one mystical body in Christ. Certainly, we don't all profess the same Christian faith, but we are all members of the one body of Christ. Let us not lose sight of that. If you were to define the church, which St. Paul speaks of to Timothy, you would define it as all the baptized in Christ. And who are they? Well, the Second Vatican Council document articulates who they are in chapter 16 of its encyclical, Lumen Gentium, Light of the People. Article 16 states that there are three types of baptism. I'm paraphrasing, but this is the gist of it. There's the baptism of sacrament, which the Orthodox and the Catholics obtain. And then there's the sacrament of baptism that the Protestants have. They're all valid baptisms. This admits us to the membership of the body of Christ. But then there's a baptism of martyrdom, baptism of blood. If you give your life for Christ, even though you're not sacramentally baptized, you don't even go to purgatory. You go straight to heaven. This is a teaching of Saint Ignatius of Antioch. It's also a teaching of other saints, and it is corroborated by Jesus Christ in approved prophetic literature, post-biblical prophetic revelation. Then there's the third type of baptism, known as ex voto, baptism of desire. What is that? And the Article 16 of Lumen Gentium articulates, all those who to no fault of their own, that's the key expression, due to no fault of their own, do not know Jesus Christ, but live according to the dictates of their conscience by doing good and avoiding evil, living by the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, right? Following that natural law that God puts into them at the moment of conception, whereby they're able to discern right or wrong in general terms, and they follow that impulse of the Holy Spirit within them, their conscience, they can attain salvation. Case in point, where were you born? Okay, think of that for a moment. Another question, what religion did your parents raise you in? Think of that. Okay, with those two things in mind, a third question, did you choose any of the two? Did you choose where you would be born? And did you choose the religion your parents would raise you in? The answer is absolutely not. Okay, then where is your merit in being raised a Christian or a Catholic or an Orthodox or a Protestant if you didn't choose that religion? You have no merit. God blessed you with that providence. He blessed you with being born in a Christian family, in a Christian environment, where you have access to the sacred scriptures and to catechetical instructions and to good religious formators. Now let us take another situation of a person who's not as privileged as you, who is not given this knowledge, but is born in, let's say, an aboriginal area, has no knowledge of the gospel, his parents are not Christian. Is that child to be impugned for that lack of knowledge? Is that child to be blamed for not having the knowledge of Jesus Christ or for his parents not teaching him that knowledge? Of course not. Just as you have no merit in being born with the faith, they have no guilt being born without it. It's not their choice. So how does God judge them? What does God expect of them? He expects them to follow the dictates of their conscience. Let me give you another example. From the expulsion of Adam and Eve of the Garden of Eden to the giving of the law through Moses, almost 2,000 years transpired with no law. Think of that for a moment. 2,000 years. That's from the time of Christ till today, pretty much. Imagine having no law. Your ancestors from the time of Christ to today have no law. Okay, the question is, how were they judged? From the expulsion of the Garden of Eden to the giving of the law to Moses, how were these Old Testament personages judged if they had no law? Well, the answer comes right out of the writings of St. Catherine of Siena's Dialogue of Divine Providence, which in Italian was simply Il Libro, the book. She did not read or write until she was an adult, and she had difficulty writing, even as an adult. And reading she had difficulty with as well. Okay. They were judged by the law of their conscience, by that natural law that Thomas Aquinas speaks of, that's given to us at conception and that God sows within us. But Jesus says in Scripture, of course, when more is given, more is demanded. So God has privileged us more, but he demands more of us than he demands of the aborigines who do not know the gospel or Jesus Christ or the sacraments. But they still can be saved. That's my point. That's the third type of baptism. Okay, so having said that, let us go to the church, all the baptized in Christ. And that begins with the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The Father creates, the Son redeems, the Spirit sanctifies, and it descends from above in and through the hierarchs, beginning with the Roman Pontiff. Through the bishops, the successors to the apostles, to the priests, whom the apostles ordained and sent out to preach and teach and administer and govern, to the religious, to the laity. This is the divine chain of command that God put in place so that we would not follow a dissident doctrine, a pernicious, schismatic, or heretical movement that leads us away from the church. So even though the church is all the baptized in Christ, of which St. Paul speaks to Timothy, it is also a structured church. It has a hierarchy. And this hierarchy God put in place, just like he did in the family. You have a parent, you have a child, you have a younger, older brother, sister. There's a hierarchy in the family, there's a hierarchy in the church, which is God's family. So let us begin with the church's three founts that reveal to us the will of God. Number one, sacred scripture. Number one, this is the normative expression or fount of our faith. Number two, sacred tradition. And this tradition embraces all that which was revealed in scripture and orally transmitted by the apostles to their listeners. That include many church fathers and doctors and saints. And that tradition, the Second Vatican Council articulated as a living, dynamic tradition, meaning it's not simply something that is confined to the past. So we cannot say, since it was old, it's good, and if it's new, it's bad. That does not work. That is not Catholic. That is not Orthodox. Because this gift that God is revealing to the church today is new. It's not old. It has its roots in the Old Testament. Adam and Eve had this gift before they sinned. Jesus and Mary had this gift, who knew no sin. That's its roots. That's its tradition. But it doesn't remain in the past. This gift was suspended for 6,000 years, reserved for its actualization in these end times, so as to oppose the opposing forces of evil that are unleashing hell against God and his church. Remember, there's strength in numbers. We Christians have to unite now more than ever. Unity is extremely important today, more than ever. And we have to pray to the Holy Spirit for the gift of discernment, so as to know who the right shepherds are we are to follow. And those right shepherds are those hierarchs that God has appointed and anointed to preach, administer, govern, and that do not displace themselves from sacred scripture or sacred tradition. The third fount of our faith, in addition to scripture and tradition, is magisterial teaching. Now, what is that? This magisterial teaching is the teaching of the church's history and present-day context that does not either deviate itself from scripture or tradition, but articulates in a new genre, a new setting and milieu, challenges, bioethical developments, technological advancements, and moral implications that have not been addressed in the past. Case in point, in vitro fertilization, artificial birth control, clonization. Where do you find this in the Bible? You don't. Where do you find this in tradition? You don't. But the Catholic Church, the Magisterium, that is the hierarchs, united to the Roman Pontiff. This is essential for magisterial teaching. If you displace yourself from the Roman Pontiff, you're breaking away from the Catholic Church. And I will go into that in a moment. And Luisa Piccarreta is the first person to remind you of this in her writings. She offered her life for the church, beginning with the Roman Pontiff. So did her compatriot from 500 years before her, St. Catherine of Siena. And there were great parallels between the two. Catherine of Siena, for example, had a very impoverished education, as did Luisa. They both had locutions at a very young age. Luisa began at 12. They both had the gift of the invisible stigmata. They both were third order Dominicans. They both offered their life to the Pope. Even Catherine of Siena went to Avignon with four priests to call Pope Gregory the 11th back to Rome when he fled to Avignon, saying, you have to go back to where you belong to guide the sheep. And he did. He listened to her. He went back about a month later after she met with him and encouraged him to go back. But then he got sick, died a year later, was succeeded by Urban. But she did her job, as did Luisa. Luisa places the gift of living in the divine will at the feet of the Roman pontiff. First and foremost, she says, first and foremost in her appeals to mankind, appeals to the Pope, then to the priest, then to you, the laity. They both made their vows to God, gave their heart to God. God gave their heart, his heart to them. They had spiritual marriage on earth. And in fact, on October 16th, 1888, when Luisa had her spiritual marriage, Catherine of Siena was present. Okay. And they both had the self-knowledge. Luisa would say, I am nothing, God is all, come divine will. Catherine of Siena had this self-knowledge, meaning that she knew her limitations then, that she said in her prayer, I am the one who is not, and you are God, the one who is. Same prayer as Luisa, I am nothing, God is all. So there are these tremendous parallels between the two. The point is, the Roman pontiff is essential to this third fountain of our revelation, which is magisterial teaching. I want to begin this online course on divine will spirituality by being grounded and encouraging you to do the same in sacred scripture, the sacred and living tradition, and magisterial teachings, okay? Now, the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith, which is a branch of the Magisterium that reviews all that which pertains to doctrine, faith, morals, put out an encyclical, a document on the vocation of the theologian, which is connected to the third fount of revelation, which is magisterial teaching. And the theologian has a vocation in the church. It's not just an office, it's a vocation that helps the magisterium avoid evil doctrines, schisms, and heretical movements, and leads the people to embrace the truth. It's called Donum Veritatis, on the gift of truth, the gift of the theologian to the church. And this is important because not even the theologian is to displace himself from scripture, tradition, or magisterial teachings that have been in place since the time of the apostles, you know, since the foundation of the Christian church. All right? Okay, now that we have those three in mind, scripture, tradition, magisterial teaching, I want to go to the gift of living in the divine will and Luisa's beginning, because Luisa was born in a little town in southeast Italy, and she was known by many of her townsfolk as well as from people outside of Italy. Padre Pio and would receive many pilgrims from throughout the world for confession, for counseling, and he would send them to Luisa Piccarreta. And when Padre Pio, Saint Padre Pio, was asked, who was Luisa? He said, she is the little angel of Corato. Because Corato was the little town in which she was born, il piccolo angelo di Corato. Okay? And there are several personages that I know that when they were alive went to Padre Pio to confession, including Adriana Palotti. And there were others like Federico Arish and Father Gustavo and others. They went to Padre Pio for confession, and Padre Pio exhorted these people to spread the divine will teachings and to welcome this gift as a gift from God. Saint Hannibal di Francia, a saint from Messina, Sicily, was appointed to Luisa to guide her. Again, the church guiding the divine will. So Saint Hannibal di Francia reviewed all Luisa's writings, and he submitted them to publication for publication, and many of them were published before he passed away. But before Saint Hannibal di Francia came, Luisa had a spiritual director also appointed again by the church to her. Father Gennaro Di Gennaro, who commanded her in the name of holy obedience to begin writing. So Luisa wasn't the individual who, some may think, wanted to inform the world of her mystical experiences. She was just the opposite. She wanted to be hidden. She did not even want to write, in fact. And when she was asked to do so, she resisted initially. She says, this is embarrassing if I do this, because there are many personal things that the Lord's revealing about me interiorly that many people are going to see. And this causes me concern. But finally, holy obedience went out, and she obeyed, and she wrote everything. And then her writings were submitted to her confessors, from Father Gennaro Di Gennaro, Father Loiodice, Father Benedictis, Father Hannibal, and so forth, Father Calvi, and they were submitted in turn with seals of official magisterial approval to the church's authorities for publication. So Luisa was from a small little town, and she didn't have a very extensive knowledge of Italian grammar. She spoke an Apulian dialect. Okay, now Jesus allowed the devil at a very young age in Luisa's life to test her, as our Lord allowed Jesus to be tested in the desert. So Luisa would be tormented, so to speak, from the age of about 4 to the age of about 11 with nightmares. Oftentimes, the devil attacks us in different ways. And one of the ways he likes to attack us is through nightmares. I'm sure there are several people out there that have experienced this as well. And these nightmares would plague Luisa until, at the age of about 11, when she entered a society at her local parish, these nightmares stopped altogether. Okay. So Luisa, when she entered this society at the church in Corato, took the name of Magdalene. And from that moment on, these nightmares stopped happening. Okay, so she was plagued by the devil that made her tremble and experience cold sweats at night. She would wake up, run to her mother, jump in her mother's arms, and recite the true prayers she knew, the Our Father, the Hail Mary. She learned them from her parents, these prayers. And she was a very timid but resolute soul. And she was so timid that when visitors would come to her home, she would hide behind her bed whenever a guest came, and she would remain behind her bed in prayer. But even though some people thought she was a little bit of an oddball, always running away from people when they came home, Jesus revealed to her that this timidity on her part was given to her by God. Jesus tells her on July 15th, 1926, "My daughter, even the shy nature with which I cloaked you in your tender age was one of my greatest jealousies toward you. I did not want anyone to influence your interior, neither people nor the world. I wanted to detach you from everything. I did not want you to partake of anything inordinate. Having from that time established that I should form the kingdom of the supreme fiat within you, and that you were to partake of its feasts and joys, it was only right that you should enjoy no other feast, but be spared of all earthly amusements, pleasures. Aren't you happy?" And much like her contemporary, St. Padre Pio Pietrelcina, Luisa was criticized by her classmates for her timidity. They didn't understand the motives behind her behavior or why God had given her, as he had given Padre Pio, this shy attitude. Jesus tells Luisa in volume 12, March 23rd, 1921, "I went around the earth over and over again, and beheld all souls one by one to find the lowliest of all. Among the many, I found you the humblest of all. I was charmed by your lowliness, and I chose you. So you see, Luisa occupies a very unique role in the history of mankind. And as I will share later, she was one of two virgins after the Virgin Mary to be chosen to come to the salvation of the human race with and through the redemption of Christ. God tells her that he chose two virgins from the human race to come to the aid of mankind. The first virgin, the queen of the divine will, the Virgin Mary, who is co-redemptrix, and this is the word our Lord uses in Luisa's writings. She co-redeemed with Christ, right? And Pope, one of the pontiffs, called Mary a co-redemptrix as well in an official document. So she's the big daughter Mary of the divine will that comes to the aid of the human race as co-redemptrix with Christ the Redeemer. But Luisa, 2,000 years later, is called to be the co-sanctificatrix, if you want to use that word. She sanctifies with the Holy Spirit. Certainly the Holy Spirit overshadowed Mary and rendered fruitful her womb whereby she gave birth to the Son of God without knowing any man. The same Holy Spirit that we receive at baptism overshadowed Luisa, who was also a virgin. Not to conceive Christ physically like Mary, no, that will never happen again, obviously. But to receive the gift that our first parents enjoyed before original sin, that Mary and Jesus enjoyed, who knew no sin, in order to restore to the church the bulwark of our faith, that primordial holiness that prepares her, the church, to espouse her bridegroom, which is Christ. Paul states in his letter to the Ephesians, Christ cannot come back to earth unless the church is found without spot, stain, blemish, or wrinkle. Therefore, the purpose of Christ choosing Luisa as the second virgin to come to the aid of the human race is none other than to prepare the church through the outpouring of this gift of the Holy Spirit with and through Luisa to prepare itself for the nuptial encounter with Christ. Pope John Paul II put out an encyclical, an apostolic exhortation, and a pastoral letter on the third millennium, that this third millennium of Christianity will be 1,000 years in which there will be a springtime of Christianity, of vocations, and unity among all Christians, where every knee will bend and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, that the meek will inherit the earth. So basically, if St. Peter in his second letter talks about fire purging the earth and its elements, and Zephaniah, whom we read last week, talks about humanity going through the fire and one-third emerging, which will be a holy people, this fire will prepare us in these end times to inherit this state of immaculacy that Paul speaks of in his letter to the Ephesians. The fire will purge all evildoers. The good will suffer with the bad, as Our Lady prophesied in Akita, Japan, approved by the church. And one third will emerge, a remnant, as in the days of Noah, a holy race. And then a millennium of peace will follow. And this millennium of peace will serve to prepare the church for its espousalship with its bridegroom, Christ. That's the purpose of the gift of living in the divine will, is to bring to actualization the Our Father prayer, where his will shall be done on earth as in heaven, which is not being done today across the globe as God desires. But there will be a time, and it's very soon, when those who are alive on earth, who remain, will live in the will of God on earth as the angels and saints live in the will of God in heaven. Okay, so Luisa was chosen by God from among all other humans. He tells her, I went around the earth over and over again and beheld all souls one by one and found the lowliest of all. Now, certainly Mary is the lowliest of all, the Virgin Mary. She even says that in the Magnificat prayer. He has looked upon the lowliness of his handmaiden. But Jesus, and when he speaks to Luisa and refers to her as the lowliest of all, he explains in other passages in her writings that this refers to her among all creatures conceived in sin. Mary was not conceived in sin. So Luisa is the lowliest of all creatures conceived in sin. That's what the Lord is referring to here. And Luisa was educated, as I mentioned, by her parents because she lived at a time when in an area where it was very poor and the people were very simple. And she learned from her parents, Vito and Rosa, who were God-fearing Catholics. And her father worked on a farm belonging to another Italian family, the Mastrorilli family, and it was located in a place called Via delle Murgia, Torre di Sperata, which was about 20 miles from Corato, about 25 kilometers from Corato. And she would spend many months of her childhood in this area because it was a custom of the Italians, especially in August, even today, to leave the city where the humidity and heat is high and go to the country in the shade where there's more air and shade, okay? And there, Luisa unfortunately did not have access to a church every Sunday. Churches were far away. So Jesus would reveal himself to her there, encourage her, counsel her, and little by little at a tender age, exhort her to always be united with him in unceasing prayer. And she was from this area of Puglia. And Puglia's tenacious and arduous soil, which brings forth in silence a rich harvest of olives. Olives are all over Puglia, where Luisa and Padre Pio lived. It's the richest olive place in all of Italy. So like Puglia's tenacious and arduous soil that brings forth in silence a rich harvest of oil, Luisa's tenacity enabled her to bravely endure many years of hardship, which would soon yield in the silent atmosphere of unceasing prayer and solitude the rich fruits of her union with God's will. So she would attend when she went back to the city after the heat and the humidity of August, July, August. She would go back and resume her education at the mother church, Chiesa Matrice, to better understand the Catholic catechism in the use at the time, which was what we call today the Catechism of Trent, more popularly the Baltimore Catechism. And she was very bright, Luisa, when she was in the first grade of education, which she did not go beyond. In Italy, she only went to the first grade and then stopped because her family was poor, like many other families too. And during her first communion, her pastor, Father Philip Furio, delivered in a homily on Jesus imprisoned in the tabernacle. This is a theme that would run throughout Luisa's Hours of the Passion work, which is one of the works that Jesus dictated to her. And she would end up writing 36 volumes. Some are very thin, some are very large, dictated by Jesus and Mary on this gift that would restore to human nature the same primordial union with the will of God that our first parents enjoyed before sin, and that has been suspended for 6,000 years, and that God wants to actualize now. So this is the purpose of Luisa's writing. She wrote 36 volumes under the obedience of her bishop, of her confessor, of her spiritual directors, and she had several. She went through five bishops, all of whom considered her a saint. And several of her writings have this official seals of the church's approval, namely the imprimatur and the nihil obstat, the highest seals that you can give to any literature in the Catholic Church. And then also she wrote other works that were dictated by Jesus and Mary as well. For example, the hours of the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, which comprise of 24 hours that I had just mentioned. The entire life of Mary, dictated by Mary to Luisa, entitled The Blessed Virgin Mary in the Kingdom of the Divine Will, which Our Lady revealed to Luisa to be read in the month of May, but that can be read really during any month, Luisa relates. Because May is the month of Mary, of course. And then Luisa also wrote her childhood memoirs, which she was asked to do. She wrote a Christmas Novena, three appeals to mankind, beginning with the Pope, going to the priest, and then to the laity, to welcome this gift that will restore the holiness that the Church needs in order to espouse Christ, its bridegroom. She also wrote an exchange of letters with several individuals, her priests and directors and so forth. And she wrote what is known as the Pious Pilgrimage of the Soul in the Divine Will, in which she makes 24 rounds throughout creation, glorifying, praising, thanking God in and through the creation he gave us. Remember, God gave Adam the world to be a steward in Genesis, the book of Genesis. And God, therefore, reawakened in Luisa the same impulse of love that he gave to Adam, whereby she, under the impulse of the Holy Spirit, went throughout creation, thanking God for all that which God gave us, praising God in and through nature. Jesus tells Luisa throughout her volumes that creation serves us and God, but that God made man the least rational, the least rationally endowed creature in the universe, to be the most noble creature of the entire universe, and to be the king and crown of all creation. Because God lifts up the lowly to high places and casts down the mighty from their thrones, like Lucifer. And she wrote a few other little treatises that I will go into when we advance in this course. I will go back very briefly to her medical experiences, because she had mystical phenomena as well that accompanied her life. She was embarrassed, Luisa, because of these mystical phenomena, just like Padre Pio was embarrassed because of his stigmata. He asked Jesus to remove the stigmata from him, Padre Pio. He said, this is the bane of my existence. Why did you allow me to have this? My confreres are persecuting me. The Church has taken away my faculties for 10 years just to examine these things. And the Lord, like he told St. Paul, said, my grace is perfected in weakness. My strength is sufficient for you through grace. So Luisa was embarrassed when she had noticed that other people saw her coming or going into a state of trance or coming out of it, of mystical transport. So, for example, at night, around 11 p.m. or 12 p.m., she would experience what's known as a mystical transport, where her soul would bilocate itself outside of her body, while her body remained impervious to external stimuli. Much like the children, let's say, during apparitions, a Fatima, or Medjugorje, or Garabandal, or wherever else, where while during the apparitions, you can pinch them, poke them, they don't feel anything. And Luisa's body was so heavy during this time, because sometimes the Lord allowed her to experience his suffering, carry his cross. And the weight was so heavy that nobody could actually move her while she was in this mystical transportive state. But no sooner had she come out of this state, around 7 or so in the morning, with the blessing of a priest, for the most part. Rarely was she able to come out of it on her own, but occasionally she was. Then she discovered her family around her, and she became very embarrassed because her family didn't know what was going on. And every morning around 6 o'clock, her family found her crouched over her bed in the seated up position, rigid immobile, and no one was able to move her limbs. Now, before I go on to articulate this experience of hers, she was bedridden because of a mystical illness for about 60 years. And this happened at the age of 13. It began around the age of 13. I mentioned from the age of about 4 to 11, she experienced nightmares from the devil. They ceased when she took the name of Magdalene at the church. And she became very devoted to Magdalene after that. In fact, she died in a place on a street called Magdalene Street, Via Maddalena. And then at the age of 12, she began to experience interior voices of Jesus and Mary, locutions, substantive locutions. There are three types of locutions that we all experience. Well, many experience too. The extraordinary gift is the third type of locution, substantive. That which Padre Pio experienced, Faustina Kowalska experienced, Luisa Piccarreta experienced, Catherine of Siena experienced, and others. We experience successive or formal locutions. I'll explain that in the next talk. Whereas Luisa experienced substantive locutions. These are extraordinary gifts. She, at the age of 12, these began. At the age of 13, she had a vision of Jesus beneath her balcony, carrying the cross, going to Calvary with a host of people jeering and mocking him, and with centurions beating him. And when he looked up at her and she connected her vision with his, and he said to her in Italian, "Soul, help me," she passed out and fell on the floor like a sack of potatoes. And her parents heard this thud upstairs because they were downstairs, and they ran upstairs and found her unconscious. And that's when her state of victimhood began. This is a vocation in the church, the office of victimhood. A person who was given a lot of sufferings to offer them up for the salvation and conversion of souls, so that souls don't go to hell. There are many individuals in the church that have had this office, from Padre Pio to Margaret of Costello, to Faustina Kowalska, you know, to Luisa Piccarreta, and the list goes on. And this began when Luisa fell on the ground. She came back to her consciousness, and her jaw was locked. She couldn't eat anything for 3 days. And this condition devolved to the point in which she could not eat or ingest anything. It would come up whenever she ate or drank anything intact, as if she never chewed it. And of course, eventually, she lost the ability to walk. And she was examined by scores of medical doctors, including priests who were also physicians. And they all came up with the same prognosis. This is a mystical illness. It defies the laws of science. We have no numerical prognosis for it. And she would remain literally surviving on the Eucharist only for about 60 years, confined to bed, similar to the conditions of Teresa Neumann and Martha Robben. And this was a beautiful gift of God to the church, because through the office of victim, God converts souls and turns them back to him. And Luisa willingly embraced this. So God progressively, like a loving father to a daughter, educated her on the science of the knowledge of the cross, to the point where she espoused the cross in her early 20s. She experienced a spiritual marriage on earth with Jesus, then a marriage of the cross within a year, then a year later, a marriage in heaven with the Trinity. And then when she was around 35 on November 16th, 1900, she experienced a fourth nuptial, an exchange of hearts. When she experienced the first marriage on earth, at which St. Catherine of Siena was present in October, that I mentioned at the outset of this talk, Jesus took possession of her heart. At the age of 35, on November 16th, 1900, she took possession of Jesus' heart. Okay. That's the difference between these nuptials that she experienced. So at the age of 18, Luisa became a third order Dominican like Catherine of Siena, and she took the name Magdalene in the presence of her pastor. And because she continued to suffer in the state of victim and to offer herself up for the victims, for example, of the cholera epidemic or the First World War and the Second World War that she experienced, that left her on numerous occasions in the state of rigidity, where her soul would bilocate outside of her body all night long. Her condition came to the attention of her archbishop, Joseph Dottula, in 1884. So he appointed to her Father Michael de Benedictis to be her confessor. And Father de Benedictis visited Luisa every day, and she in turn revealed her soul to him like an open book. And he would impose restrictions on her sufferings so she could accept whatever the Lord asked her to do in obedience with the church. See, this is how loyal, obedient Luisa was with the church. She never did anything without the representative, the priest, consenting to what she did. And what does this tell us in these end times? If we are to live in the divine will as Jesus taught Luisa, then we should do the same. So even the sufferings God sent her to endure for the salvation of souls, Jesus would not allow her to endure without permission from a priest guiding her. Imagine that. Even if the salvation of souls depended upon her sufferings, Jesus would not allow her to suffer unless the priest given to her would permit it. And Father De Benedictis would impose restrictions on her sufferings in her state of victim. And it was during this time that Luisa received permission to remain continuously in bed and to abstain from eating, except for one small meal a day, which she always regurgitated whole and intact. And as I mentioned, she would remain confined to bed in her state of victimhood, living almost exclusively on the Eucharist and the divine will for the rest of her life, nearly 60 years in all, between 1881 to 1947. Although she would remain confined to bed and under the counsel of several confessors, most of whom she outlived, she never suffered any physical illness, except for the pneumonia that took her life in 1947. Okay, so I'll conclude there and I'll end with a prayer and a blessing. Heavenly Father, we beseech you through the intercession of our Lord Jesus Christ, who intercedes on our behalf before your throne, through the intercession of the Mother and Queen of the Divine Will, the Blessed Virgin Mary, who is our Mother, and through the intercession of the little daughter of the Divine Will, Luisa Piccarreta, so that we may receive the full outpouring in these end times of the Holy Spirit, whose power infinitely surpasses that of evil, so that we may be protected in mind, body, and soul. And may your will come upon us, and may the blessing of Almighty God be extended to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, till next week, may God bless you and keep you. Amen.